Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to begin the next session. May I request you all to take your seats? Sing my song. Well-known Carnatic musician and Sangeetha Kalanidhi Sanjay Subrahmanyan will discuss the duality of performance and creativity, of tradition and individuality with Nirmala Lakshman. May we have you both up on stage, please?
I'm delighted and very honored to welcome Sangeetha Kalanidhi Sri Sanjay Subrahmanyan to the Hindu Lit for Life, the Hindus Festival of Literature. The Music Academy this year conferred the august title on this maestro, who is among one of the youngest musicians to ever receive this award. As Sri Rama Varma, the eminent musician, rightly pointed out, Sanjay is an exceptional musician with the full impact of the word exceptional. He also correctly added that Sanjay has that X factor, the combination of artistic merit as well as star value. His concerts, both in India and abroad, have drawn large audiences with overflowing auditoriums. Today, we are privileged to have the opportunity to discuss with him, and hopefully there'll be room for a few questions at the end, the marvelous journey that he has made and his personal perceptions of his own outstanding music as well as the Carnatic music tradition. Sanjay, thank you again for coming, and may I begin by offering mine, and indeed, if I may, this audience's congratulations on the Sangeetha Kalanidhi title.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here today, and I'm sorry if I'm not appropriately dressed for this occasion, but I thought this is appropriate for this occasion.
I think you're very, very elegantly attired. I think the audience is just delighted to have your presence here with us. And I would like to begin by asking you, during your presidential address at the Music Academy, you said that this title confers on you a sense of massive responsibility. Can you elaborate on that?
See, the point is that in the past, the title of Sangeetha Kalanidhi was generally given to somebody who had almost stopped singing concerts. And I don't think I am at that stage at the moment. So that is one of the biggest responsibilities, to continue singing concerts and continue delivering what I've been doing all these years. And I believe that people who have taken the Howrah Mail from Chennai to Calcutta will know that the longest station is Voltaire, where you get down and have lunch and come back. So for me, this is like a Voltaire station, you know, I have to take a breather and then get back to what I'm doing.
But you're going to get on the train again.
Absolutely.
And I just wanted to know, how do you perceive your journey forward, given this notion of massive responsibility?
No, as far as I'm concerned, this responsibility is separate, and my continuation of my journey is the same, because the destination is defined. You just keep pursuing excellence in artistic endeavors, and that's the only journey that keeps me going. So the award is incidental, and it comes at a time when you know, you feel happy, and you know, it's a nice feeling.
That's great. There's also, I mean, like, let me begin by asking you about the whole perception of the Carnatic music tradition as being somewhat static, traditional, because a lot of people here, I mean, are Carnatic music aficionados and they know everything, but I'd still like to ask on behalf of a lot of people who may not be so tuned into this tradition. There is a feeling that it's kind of restrictive and not really, hadn't really moved forward. How would you respond to that?
See, this concept of restrictive nature of art seems to be particularly targeted at Carnatic music in recent times. Probably because the art form is a soft target. You know, there's not too many people coming out with responses or answers. So I thought I'll address a couple of these things recently in my speech also, when I said that restrictions breed creativity. You know, you come out with newer things when you are actually restricted by something. For instance, I know there are painters who are restricted by the size of their canvas. You know, once they decide this is the size, that is a restriction. And for a writer as well, I suppose you decide to write a short story, you can't write it for 1,500 pages. So that is a restriction in that sense. Or even a subject. For instance, you want to base your novel in Chennai, or you want to base your novel in Beijing, whatever it is still a restriction. So these kinds of restrictions are imposed either by the self or to a reasonable extent by the system. For instance, in Carnatic music's case, we are performing in a particular conventional system where there is a singer and there are a couple of accompanying artists, and then we pursue compositions which have been handed down traditionally, but they have changed. You know, how has tradition evolved? I don't sing Oranga Sai the way Tyagaraja composed it in 1820s. It has changed so much, it has evolved, and so many musicians have given their own to how the composition has evolved over the period of time. And we are just continuing on that, adding our own whatever we can to the same composition. So to that extent, tradition is evolving and continuously changing. It is not static. It will never be static.
Do you think in that sense there has been a period of great innovation in tradition? Have there been particular periods over the last few decades, or do you see that it moves dynamically in a linear form, or have there been bursts of creativity which kind of still within the tradition that you talked about, but at the same time given an extra substance or dimension to the music?
See, one of the challenges in identifying change in Carnatic music is lack of documentation. Now, prior to say 70, 80 years, the documentation is extremely scanty. We just hear say a lot of things. See, they say in those days they used to sing Devagandhari for 7 days. Now, how can you sing a ragam for 7 days? It's not possible. Try singing Devagandhari for 7 minutes. It's difficult. You know, you may sing Todi for 7 minutes, but Devagandhari is difficult. So, given that, see, there is a lot of scanty documentation regarding how things were. For instance, there is an academy address by T.R. Venkatram Sastri, where he says that there is a misconception that people used to sing for 4.5 hours or 6.5 hours. That's not true. Concerts were only of 3 hours or 3.5 hours duration. So this perception is always, you know, distorted by the amount of documentation that we face. Coming to actual creative endeavors and how they have changed, all art forms go through these periods of turbulence, you know, when somebody comes up, challenges it. But these challenges have to be fundamental. They should not be cosmetic. You know, cosmetic changes will not cause deep differences. Only fundamental changes. See, like when Dikshitar came up with a way of composing compositions, or Tyagaraja tapped into the beauty of the Carnatic music system and came up with compositions in so many different ragas, it spurred creativity. The kind of change that the Trinity brought in, the Trinity that we call Tyagaraja, Dikshitar, Shama Sastri, and the post-Trinity period where the music composers who followed them, all of them gave so much to the music that it takes 100 years for us to digest them, enjoy them, and share it with the people. So you need that time for people to take it in before you can go into the next burst of creativity when it's so fundamental. See, it can't change every 10 years or 15 years. So you have to allow people to take in. For instance, a technological change, by the time it reaches India, it takes 5 years. Some changes. So talk about artistic change, how much longer it might take. So that, to that extent, you have to allow these things. But there will be changes. Like, for instance, you take the format. They say that the format was different in the 19th century. Then you came to a concert format which is more palatable. Now, the format changes because of so many things. One of which is the audience. One of it is where the concerts are being performed. You come from a private ambience to a public space. You know, you sing in a darbar in front of a king with 15 people. You can do anything you want. You know, you can talk, you can sing, you can get up and go and come back and sing, and nobody is going to say anything. But you can't do that in a public space where there are 500 people sitting in a temple. So then what happens is you reorient what you're doing to that audience immediately. See, the temple space becoming a public space for cultural events itself is much later rather than much earlier. So to that extent, the art form evolves slowly, and there are changes that happen to the system, to the structure. Then you see the entrance of technology. For instance, once the microphone comes, you can't sing the way you sang before. So you have to, then what happens? People start using their voices differently, the instruments differently. For instance, you want to sing a mic-less concert, the voice cannot be louder than the mridanga. It's very difficult. So they sang at a higher pitch. Once the microphone came, you can modulate it. So I can actually say, mridangam, please lower the volume, you know. And then they'll get upset with me, and then there'll be a slanging match between the two of us, and everybody will be increasing the volume and all that. But these things happen because that's what technology brings in. So you can't escape that. So,
you talked about the different kinds of ambiances which the singer is exposed to. You yourself, I mean, starting with that, could we talk about how you yourself moved from learning, from being a student, from being a child, through your growing up years, through the tutelage, first exposure with your parents, you said your immediate family, your siblings also knew music, and then to your great aunt Rukmini Rajagopalan, your Rukmini party, and then Calcutta Krishnamurti, and subsequently you learned the Nadaswaram also. So could you talk about how you moved from your home ambience to the public space.
See, typically,
and some stories also.
See, typically, people like you and other Tambram girls learned music for a specific purpose.
I hope you're not going to ask me to sing.
But I enjoyed the sundal in everybody's house during Navaratri. So I said, if I sang a few songs, I'll get a little more. So that was my intro to music when I was young. But all my aunts, everybody used to sing at home. You know, I was very responsive to music as opposed to other art forms when I was younger. The only other thing that I was strongly attracted to was cricket, and I still am. But thankfully for Indian team, you know, they lost out on a good opening batsman. But the thing is that what happened is when you move in that kind of a family circle and you learn music like everybody and you give excuses to not go to violin class. You know, I used to go along Lloyd's Road with my violin in my hand, and on the road somebody will look at you and say, Thambi, veena ya? I mean, violin itrundu irukku veena perusa irukum, but he wouldn't know the difference, you know. You can't blame him for that. So appo vandu when you are 7 or 8, you would look at him and say, the violin, you know, you get very angry, you know. You can see that happening when some people are traveling in the airlines and somebody says, sir, Air India, Jet Airways, as if it's a big thing. So you feel so proud that you're learning something, and that guy. So from that stage, you know, you go on, and then the violin is a very difficult instrument, okay. The first 2 years, I think we should all be given soundproof rooms to practice. Because it's such a strain on your immediate family when you're learning the violin. And from that, you know, I kind of gave it up in about 6-7 years and started singing. And we used to go to these college competitions, school competitions and all that. And if you go to a Tyagaraja Kriti's competition in the music academy, you will feel like you're in WCC or Ethiraj or Stella Maris. It was a virtual women domain. Okay, there were 2 boys or 3 boys, and then TM Tyagarajan will come as the judge and say, Pa, and the payinu or consolation prize kudu abdim. So at least you get something for yourself so that you take up music seriously, and that was how we were looked at. And then, you know, there was a real revolution in Carnatic music in the late 80s, early 90s, because a lot of young people like us who were in colleges and just out of colleges felt that there was not opportunities in the Sabha system and the infrastructure, and we created it ourselves. We said, let's form an organization. We formed the YACM. We had concerts. The festivals were very successful. The Rasika supported us. The musicians support. First thing that we did the first year was go to every senior musician's house, do namaskaram and give him the invitation. And said, sir, we want your support. And we called every day, we called one of them as a chief guest. So they were very happy that they were giving the importance, they were given the respect and everything. So these kids are good, you know. And we were all there, each one was the disciple of the other. So we kind of slowly eliminated those ego issues among ourselves until we started making money. That's when the thing started among ourselves.
That's lovely. What makes you, when did you transition from being an amateur to a professional, what is known as a professional? You did mention that your Rukmani Party, who was such an expert, would sing at the All India Radio, and she would still call herself an amateur artist, whereas she is the person whom you imbibed a great deal of musical knowledge from. Similarly, you said there have been other, you mentioned your passion for cricket, you talked about gentleman player concept. But when does that become something else, the professional, the artist? Or is that just a mental kind of a, you know, division that really doesn't exist for someone like you? I mean, the movement.
This concept of profession, artist, these things will make for good reading when you write a column. But in our minds, all artists, you know, see, we need to make money. And we have chosen the arts as our motive to make money, like everybody else chooses something. And we are grateful that the society supports us. See, you need a bountiful society, a society that is doing well, to be able to support the arts to make us earn a living, a decent living. So to that extent, it influences all artists. But what happens is we should not allow that to get in the way of what we create on stage or when we perform. We try to ensure that it's not, like for instance, when I come to sing a todi, I cannot say that this is the amount of satisfaction you will get when I sing a todi. You can say that with a 5 rupee soap and say this is what the soap will do. But I can't guarantee that each one of you is going to get the same kind of experience that I will give. So there what happens is if 10 people have 10 different opinions about my concert, I'm successful. I want people to have different opinions. I mean, that is the first thing that the artist wants. One guy can feel very happy. The other guy can feel, you know, a bit relieved that he was tired. The other guy could have gone to sleep. It doesn't matter. But the point is that if I gave the same kind of experience to everybody, I'm selling a product. I'm not creating art. Art is about having those things there.
That would lead me to ask you, what kind of energy then do you draw from an audience? I mean, how important is it when you sit in a kacheri for you to look around and see the responsiveness, or does it not matter to you when you come on stage? Could you just tell us very specifically if you said that there is an impact, or you you are aware of the reactions of different people to your concert, but how does that actually flow into a particular performance, the energy?
See, performers thrive on audience energy. See, if we don't, if I close my eyes and I'm oblivious to all you guys sitting here, then I might as well do it at home. There is an energy emanating from people sitting in the audience, and we have to feed off that emergence, that energy. It's like, you know, you walk out into the Wankhede stadium with 45,000 people cheering, and the first ball you drive for a boundary, can you imagine what will be going through that guy's mind when he does that? Imagine Virendra Sehwag hitting the first ball for a sixer. I mean, it's like the adrenaline. Even now I can feel the adrenaline flowing. I wouldn't be so agitated if not for the occasion, if not for the number of people sitting here, because you feed off that energy. That's what happens when you're in public. So this is. But at the same time, what happens is there is over-eagerness. You know, you want to do well. You want to impress people. You want to create an impact. And then, you know, there you can tend to lose control. So what happens is there's my party used to say some nice things. Listen, modalla moonu paattu therinja paatta paadu, sing songs that you know, don't try in the beginning, you know, let everybody get into the rhythm. You know, there are people still walking in, there are still people walking out from the previous concert, the mics are still a bit unstable, the accompanists are still settling in, allow it. See, in Yorkshire there is a statement, no square cuts before lunch. You know, let the ball go outside the off stump. It's like that, you know, allow the first 3-4 songs, then let them be songs that you know very well. Even in fact, in this year's Academy concert, I had decided I'm going to sing this very rare Varnam in Vachaspati for the first song. That morning already, you know, there was a lot of excitement and things like that. And then by the afternoon before I had my lunch, I said, no, this is not going to work. Let me go to the time-tested Kalyani Varnam. I have sung 1,500 times in my concerts. And given the audience and given the occasion and given the ambience that was there, if I had not done that, I would have forgotten the second line, looked around here and there, fumbled a bit, and, you know, it taken longer to settle down. So the point is, you get into familiar territory quickly in a performance, so that, you know, then you are in sure territory, and then you feed off the audience. But there is also another thing. They always say that in concerts, public concerts, closed auditoriums versus the pandal concert, you know, where automatically the crowd is big, the air is open, and you tend to raise your voice a bit more, as opposed to a chamber audience where it's small and you can do a lot of subtle things that will reach across the people easily, as opposed to a large audience there. So what happens is automatically what you sing or how you sing changes based on the audience, based on the place and everything like that.
So, I mean, that would probably flow into the fact that some people are performers and some people are artists. So you have that kind of control where you pick up from the vibrations or the presence, and like you said, you changed your mind.
Adur Gopalakrishnan once said, you know, yeah, everything is cinema.
Okay.
You know, so it is a performance, and we are all artists. So, I mean, there is a duality that you are working with continuously all the time.
So you are both a performer and an artist.
You call me what you want, I don't care. Get the people into my concerts. I really don't care, it doesn't matter.
But I think you do move into the realm of artistry, Sanjay, for several reasons, obviously. The work that you've done with melody, with the exploration of what is called the Vivadi tradition. You are the one who has mainstreamed it. Your exploration, or rather your bringing back after the whole Tamil controversy in the early 40s, 50s, you brought Tamil songs back into the forefront. And also your own contribution in terms of your vast repertoire. Is this all a conscious movement, or is it that you want to be inclusive? Do you think about it before? Do you assess your own body of work each time, or is there a gap in between your kacheris where you feel this is what the way forward is?
See, definitely a lot of work goes into planning. You know, you have to plan what you are doing. You think about it. You work on your repertoire every year before December. You know, everybody uses Evernote. You know, it's one software that you use where you make notes and you jot it down and then you look back and you see what you have noted, things like that. See, I'm a very compulsive technology user. So it has helped me in record. For instance, last 6 years, 7 years, I actually recorded the songs that I was singing in my concerts. And you realize when you go to Madurai or you go to Bangalore, what have you sung the last time? Or what? So let's try and sing something else. So you don't want to be repetitive and you are constantly challenging yourself. So if you don't want to be repetitive, then you have to sing more songs. And if you want to sing newer songs, which are fresh and able to create an impact, then you have to sing it that many more times to get it on stage. So you keep working on these things. As far as the work regarding Vivadi Madams or regarding, see, Vivadi, it's a very interesting concept, you know, because you take a raga like Jog and say, ga ma ga sa. No, this is not Vivadi, two gas. Ga ma re sa. Ade gava, you call it re, it becomes Vivadi. But the melody is the same. In we call it nata, for instance, you know. So the point is that this concept of Vivadi is a little bit tricky because it is not included in your basic lessons. So the musicians, after a point of time when they actually start singing, they get exposure to some of these ragams and then they want to sing it. So then, because of the lack of practice, they try to ignore it and say, Vivadi la dosha, you know, it's not good. But there is no dosham. Enough music. Why would Tyagaraja compose a song in Vivadi if it had dosham? Or why would Dikshitar compose a song in the Vivadi? So that's not true. It's about being able to present it, work on it, and get it out on stage. Similarly, as far as Tamil is concerned, it was pure language chauvinism at one point of time that prevented musicians from actually accepting Tamil songs in their repertoire. Unfortunately, what happened, by the time people wanted to sing Tamil songs, it got hijacked by a political movement. So once the political movement went into that hands, these guys became even more rigid and said, no, we should not sing Tamil, you know, it will have, it will be called Dravidian or it will be called something like that. So then what happens is there is this fear that, you know, you are unnecessarily, but that's not what it is. You are singing in Todi, you are singing in Bhairavi, you are singing in Kambodi. What does it matter if it is in Kannada or Telugu or Tamil or what is it? Even if it's Chinese, it doesn't matter. The point is, it should be relevant. You know, I should be able to convince you about what I'm singing and may engage you. That is the main thing. Now, if I'm not able to engage you at that point of time, then it won't work. So that is how you work and bring these elements into your repertoire.
But there's something to be said about being a native speaker of the language, right? I mean, you may enjoy opera, but you will take away something different from the person who really knows the language of the opera. Similarly, you singing a Tamil song, the lyrics would mean more to you than, say, somebody else. And so what is your take on that, in the sense that do you believe that that should be cultivated, or should musicians also attempt to understand the language, if not learn the language, of a lot of the work, the compositions that they're dealing with?
See, there is a perception, you know, for instance, sir, when Nedanuri says Ra Rama Inti Daka, you feel like calling Rama inside. But when I sing Ra Rama Inti Daka, it sounds something different. But it's a perception. Similarly, when I sing a Tamil song, I feel confident of articulating the lyrics better. It's purely a mindset. But if I were to spend a little more time in reading the lyric, trying to find out what it means, and trying to articulate it a little better, then definitely the effect will be superior. I mean, that's been shown by several musicians. But still, the native speaker definitely has an advantage in being able to articulate the lyrics. See, when you articulate the lyrics with that level of knowledge, then the musicality also changes. Automatically, the musicality changes. Vavel Muruga. Abdina, the Vavan Solrache, you know you are calling the Muruga. So, the Vavel Muruga. So, you Vavali Atano. Vavel Muruga. Deva Guru Nadane and Kavai. Vegudurithum, my ing Vava. So, automatically, as you are calling, as you are Vegudurithum, Deva Guru Nadane and Kavai. So you just bring, the point is you are able to bring those elements of articulation slightly better. I would like to do this in other languages as well. But then my audience again is predominantly Tamil. It's 80%, 90%, whatever it is. It's predominantly, but when you go outside, you have to work around it. So then you choose repertoire, you choose compositions, and then, but it takes a little bit more work, you know. I have to stop watching some cricket matches for that.
So what is your view then on these thematic conference concerts and the way in which people are trying to probably popularize a composer or a way of singing? What is your take on that, given that you've believe that you're strongest in your native language. At the same time, you would like to explore other musical traditions or other compositions. What is your feeling? What does that do actually when you create thematic concerts?
See, thematic concerts create a specific, they serve a specific purpose. For instance, in television every year we have the Margari Mahotsavam, where I work on specific Tamil composers. Sometimes you land on composers which, say for 1 year I sang Durasami Kavirayar compositions, and one guy emailed me saying, "Sir, there is nothing in Google about this man." Now that was a new thing for him, poor guy. But and now if you go to Google, you'll find reference to my concert. But the point is that there is so much of musical material available that we need to, you know, tap into. And sometimes thematic concerts give you the opportunity to concentrate on one composer or one type of composition, and then you present it. And then after that, how much of it gets back into the concert mainstream is a personal choice, because you're dealing, there is a computer database that has lists about 46,000 compositions that have been documented in Carnatic music. Now there's no way we are going to tap into even a small percentage of that. So it's each individual's choice to, you know, see what attracts them. Some may attract lyrically, some may attract musically, some may attract just for the sake of novelty. You know, I'm presenting something new. Sometimes you go back to the tried and tested songs. You like to sing a Viriboni, you like to sing a Orangasai, you like to sing Koniyadi Nanape. So you go back to the, so the balance is always, you know, you're always working on trying to achieve that little bit of balance here, you know, getting a little bit unfamiliar, some familiar, something new, something old and all that. So at different points of time, your minds go on a tangent. You know, you want to work on a particular set of songs, a particular set of ragas. It keeps building from time to time.
So then technology, obviously, like you said, has a great impact in the terms of the wealth of information it provides. Does that create people who think that they're musicians but maybe just not just performers? And what has been the impact of this in create, you know, you have lessons on Skype. I'm not belittling that. I think certainly it has a value. But what is the difference between learning music with the new technology, with the help of Google, whatever, and actually sitting with a guru and learning and going through the kind of experiences that you had?
See, as far as Carnatic music is concerned, my personal belief is learning from a guru is superior to all other forms of learning. But in today's world, we have to face reality. I mean, it's difficult for somebody to find the time, you know, and we are doing too many things at the same time. So technology gives you that quick, way of accessing a guru and learning from him and all that. But still, the basic lessons, or at least the first few years, it's much, much better to, you know, learn from a proper teacher, guru, and then, you know, continue with it. But as far as technology is concerned, another problem with, like you said, everybody thinks they're musicians, or everybody thinks they're critics as well. You know, you sing one the same song in Trivandrum, in Bangalore, in Los Angeles, and next day in Calcutta, and then somebody says, "Sanjay is obsessed with that same song." But 40 years back, before GNB sang a composition in the academy, he would sing it in every venue to get it, give it that finish, so that by the time when he came to the academy and sang it, it was in perfect form. I mean, that's why they did it. Like when MLV sang a Ragam Thanam Pallavi in Manirangu, she would start first by singing one line as a Ragamalika Swaram in the end. And then she would sing a small composition in the beginning of the concert. And then one day she would sing Mama Pattabhinama with a little bit of Raga Lapana. And at the end of a series of 15-20 concerts, she would sing a Ragam Thanam Pallavi in Manirangu. So the musical mind is actually slowly attuning to an unfamiliar raga, singing it in different concerts over a period of time, and building up to a stage where the mind is able to elaborate on the raga and present to the fullest of the musician's imagination and what the raga has to offer. So this kind of things sometimes get sidetracked because somebody comes and says he's singing the same song again and again. No, that's not why I'm singing it. I'm also singing to a different audience every time. That never gets highlighted. So that is another problem with the way technology. But today, see, what we have on YouTube, in those days you had to go to some mama's house for a recording of 1 hour, a concert. Sir, you should have heard 4.5 hours, sir. 1935, I have heard first time Raman Jengar in Madras. Sir, tape. Wait, sit down. And the 1 hour D90 TDK cassette, to get out of him, I have to listen to 4 hours of this. Today, you sit at home, one click, 4 TB is in your hard disk. Immediately. So that is what, but that is fantastic, you know, in the sense that a really discerning mind, somebody who can look for what they want, can get so much immediately. If you're able to use it, good luck. I mean, that's what we want.
You spoke about, Srimati DKP and others who worked on specific compositions and sang it everywhere and all, and you know, practiced it to perfection. In your case also, I know that you go through those exercises, but there is such a thing as what happens when you're on stage, right? I mean, you have that freedom to sing an alapane for 2 minutes, 20 minutes, and there's and it may be something familiar, like you said, and you might have sung it at different concerts, but people leave feeling that was fantastic, and they're not, they may not have the words to even comprehend why they experienced that. Now, how would, is that the mark of, oh, let's say, genius? What do you, I mean, what do you feel is distinguishes somebody who's a master of that?
See, the point is, taking risks on stage is a particular character. You know, for instance, when Sachin Tendulkar came on the stage first time, Trevor Bailey said in BBC, he has a problem with playing like Gavaskar or like Richards. Because he had 4 shots to every ball. And the point is the choice that you take. You can take the safe route or you can take the daring route and, you know, even fail. But the point is you shouldn't be afraid of failure. I mean, for me earlier on, I was never afraid of failure. I didn't care. You know, on stage I sit, if an idea strikes me musically, I have to sing it. Whether I pull it off or not is another matter. But you had enthusiasm on your side and you were young and your audience were your family. So you had no problems pulling it off. So you had no problems pulling it off. You can do whatever you want and they'll say, Nambathu koyanda enna alaga padithupaaru. That's what you wanted, you know. So you could take risks at will, but it gives you, it, see, but that's not what it is. It's also the work that you do at home. So that over a period of time, the work you do at home and the risks to, that you do on stage start paying off. And then all those, you know, tricky, like the Australian captain once said, you know, once you, the team start winning, the decisions go their way. Then you don't need DRS because even the wrong decisions will help that team. So it's like that, you know, once you put in the time, automatically things start happening well, and then you're able to pull off more often than not. So that is the confidence that you take. This is something that most great musicians have done, but that is not the only thing that makes masters. Whatever said and done, the 10,000 hour rule or whatever it is, it works for everybody. You have to put in the time. You have to work hard. You have to spend time in the nets. You have to sit at home in your room and sing a composition 100 times or 200 times. A writer has to write every day. That's what they say. I mean, they said that Hemingway rewrote Old Man and the Sea 53 times or whatever it is. I mean, that's what it is. So you have that. That still makes whatever a musician is. You can never take that away from anybody, any artist for that matter.
But everyone who does this Malcolm Gladwell thing of 10,000 hours, do they all, become musicians?
I'm sorry, but that it's not a foolproof scheme. It's not a foolproof scheme.
So Sanjay, basically that exceptional quality, do you feel that the younger people today have the patience and have the persistence to move ahead, having recognized it in themselves and move towards creating and being good musicians? Or do you think that a lot of them are still distracted by other things? Because I find that younger audiences, I mean, the sabhas are still filled with 50 plus, let's say. Though the youngsters are learning and performing and doing a variety of things. But to the Carnatic music tradition, how many of them do you think will really come or keep coming?
See, the audience average has been above 50 for the last 50 years. How is it possible? The moment you have children, you want them to have the best things, and then you start listening to the music first. Because your children are learning to it. It's like that. That's fine. I mean, you will always have 50 plus people getting back to this art form, and it's happened for the last 56 years. That's fine. The other thing is that as far as the youngsters are concerned, if you had asked me this question 30 years ago and said, are the youngsters, do they have it in them to do it? I would have said yes. And today also I will say yes. Because the youngsters are smart, they are intelligent, and they are hardworking. Otherwise, they would not have got as skillful as they have. So by the time they're 8 or they're very, very hardworking. Absolutely, you can clap. it's a fashion to say that youngsters these days. I mean, I don't believe in that. I'm a positive guy. And I believe that all youngsters are very, very smart and hardworking. So they will, I mean, the point is, the system offers a kind of environment which you have to be smart enough to use to the best of your abilities. But beyond all that, on stage, what you deliver is what is important. Other things off stage I mean, they work for a few years, for a limited period of time. Like my uncle once said, he's an advertising executive. He said, you can sell a bad product once with a good marketing campaign.
Right.
Your product has to be good. If your product is not good, then your marketing cannot sell it consistently. That's the thing.
How much do you draw from your accompanists during a kacheri? What is the role that they play? Very often, you know them individually, but they never get the kind of limelight or light shone on them like the major, the vocalist does. So what is your thinking about accompanists and their support?
See, it's so important that only now you heard me sing without accompanists. Some 5 minutes back. Otherwise, even the violinist gets to play alone on stage. The mridangam gets to play alone when he's playing. I never get to sing alone. I never get to sing alone. So that means that I am dependent largely on my accompanists and their desire to contribute to the success of the concert. If an ego issue comes in the way, then I'd rather sing with somebody else. I make my choices very clearly. So to that extent, the accompanists understand that. And I am very fortunate that the people who have played with me, whom I have worked with, have all been very cooperative, and they understand this spirit in which we are performing. It's not oneness or it's not, teamwork, nothing like that. But there is an element. See, they are artists as well, and they need to be respected. They need to be recognized. And we try our best to give them the space and the time to do what they want to do. I mean, within what we have defined as the parameters of our performance space. I mean, for instance, you can have a guy hogging the limelight in a film for 45 minutes and one guy comes in one scene and everybody is talking about that. That can also happen. I should have the graciousness to accept it if it happens in my concert. You know, that is when I'm giving my accompanist respect.
Also, you spoke about, you've been talking a lot about cricket during this conversation and your passion for that is obvious. I also understand that you're very passionately interested in board games. One other question, so many singers and musicians take to the film. You've consciously stayed away from that. Is there a reason for that?
Yeah, I have actually sung in one film, a film that was made on me. But beyond that, yes, I did receive offers from the Tamil film industry to sing, but I chose not to because, see, at that point of time, the focus was important, and my guru once said, "Eda onera keta adapna, kekala ana keta bohada." I mean, he didn't want me to sing, and not that it was not just his advice or anything, but I also felt that there is a shift away from what you want to do. I mean, sometimes it's better to do the things that you do well and you stick to that. You'd be able to do them better. And if you try to do too many things, then it distracts you and you're not able to continue in the same framework. So that's one of the reasons why. And I don't have any issues with other people singing, or for that matter, the film music is very beautiful, and I listen to a lot of film music. Personally, I have taken a choice to not sing in films because of, my focus and my attention to what I'm doing. That's all.
So do you listen to a lot of other kinds of music, and what has been your...
Yes, I listen to... It's a rap, so...
So he won't let him dodge, he has to answer that.
Okay, so yes, I do listen to a lot of... The point was, there was one point of time when I was young when I listened to Ilaiyaraaja a lot. We grew up listening to Ilaiyaraaja, and that was our childhood, school, college and all that. And then for a long period of time, say about 15, 20 years, I literally listened to nothing but Carnatic music because you were involved in it and all that. And then after a while, you were looking at inspiration from others, other art forms, other music. And then you start listening to Hindustani music, to ghazals, to even English music, Beatles, whatever, So different forms, Western classical, everything I started listening to. But now I read books, I play board games, I go to painting shows, I watch theater, I watch films, I do everything, I'm kind of, an art, whatever.
I think we'll wrap up, but I'm sure they want to ask a few questions. So thank you very much for those wonderful insights. And I think a lot of people are going away. More than anything, for setting a lovely tone to this festival, very grateful for that. Thank you so much for making the time, but... Can we open
sure,
the floor
sure,
to a few questions?
308 for 8, India. Rohit Sharma, 124. Rahane, 89. Kohli, 59. You think we can hold this, defend this? No, but seriously. Now, you don't sing at weddings.
Yes, I don't.
Then the next question is, if you permit it, taking risks. Anton Chekhov famously said in one of his letters, he's an emancipated thinker who's not afraid to write foolish things. Who's not afraid to write foolish things. Does that apply to a musician? You hinted at that, but could you tell us?
Yeah, when you take risks, you may look like a fool on stage. And you should be willing to. See, like, my father was a theater actor. He acted in Cho Ramaswamy's plays. And he said, if you don't have what it takes to bear yourself on stage, you shouldn't be on stage. So when you actually bear yourself, you are exposing yourself to, you know, whatever it is. So when you take risks, you will look like a fool sometimes when it doesn't come off. That's part of the whole thing. Coming to 308 for 8, there was a time when one batsman kept scoring hundreds, India kept losing matches. I don't want that to happen to Rohit Sharma.
Is it on? Can grow and flourish abroad. And as an addendum,
I live in India, so I don't know the scene abroad. But what do you mean?
I mean, do they need to move to Chennai to flourish, is my point.
You have to ask a musician who lives outside, it's like this, you know. If you want to make it in Hindi films, you can't live in Thiruvananthapuram. This is the Carnatic music capital of the world, so let's face it. I mean, we are proud of it. You come here, you will get attention, definitely. And do well, of course.
I would like to know how you rate press reviews about your concerts.
I'm going to answer that.
You want me to say this in a festival run by the press?
Freedom of expression,
of course. No, see, the point is that it's no different from anybody else's review. For instance, at the end of a concert, one mama got up and said, he sang very well today, but he should not have sung Kalyani. Because that mama doesn't like Kalyani. So that's possible. So those kinds of reviews will also come. Of course, you will also have the scoreboard listing of, Rohit Sharma, 124, Rahane, 89, just the score. And no other comments about the concert as well. And sometimes a critic's personal viewpoint of how music should be, rather than what he heard that day, can also be put forth as a result. We have to have the stomach to take all that in. That's all.
But do you actually read them?
Of course I read. I read every word of whatever is written about me in public. Including internet websites and blogs and tweets. Sometimes I search my name on Twitter if it is not tagged to my name. So all of you beware.
Good afternoon, sir. Congrats on the award. One question that I wanted to ask, now that you've been awarded the award, I just wanted to know, because you're an avid cricket fan as well, cricket has become a tool of national integration. Why hasn't Carnatic music gone to that level?
Because 11 people have to sing on stage.
Yeah, but I'm just trying to...
Otherwise, how can it be? Three people...
No, I'm...
sorry. No, but yeah, tell me.
From... We have a grassroots structure in the game, but we don't see that in Carnatic music. It could be a tool of great...
No, Carnatic music has a grassroots structure among the people to whom it caters and is supported by.
That's like supporting the Bombay School of Batsmanship. Everybody has a great will.
Who scored 100 today?
Yeah, but we need a Dhoni, right?
And yeah, but still the guy who scored the 100, no?
But who won us the World Cup, sir? So
who scored 1,009 runs yesterday?
So we need a grassroots level.
Who scored 3,400s first? Who scored 10,000 runs first?
So we're
Bombay is Bombay. They won Ranji Trophy 36 times.
So does that mean that we don't allow a player from Jharkhand to come in?
That's not true. Dhoni is the captain.
Yeah.
So Ashwin is the brains.
Yeah. Ashwin is the brains. Dhoni is the captain, sir. But that's because they have a grassroots level, right?
Buzz, what's your point?
My point is... As somebody who's at a responsible position in the...
I am not in any responsible... I don't run any organization. No, but then I'm a private individual.
Yeah, great. I appreciate that. But then you said that the award instilled on you a great sense of responsibility.
Personal responsibility, not public.
As giving back to music what you...
I'm singing every day. I give more concerts. I've accepted more concerts than last year.
Great. Apart from that, are you also trying to include more... go to schools and also get students...
No. I'm not doing that.
But then don't you fear that Carnatic music is going to be a diminishing tradition?
No, it won't be.
I think he answered some of that during this conversation.
No, it won't be. It won't be. Don't worry.
Oh, okay. Thank you, sir.
Can we move to... we can take two more questions. We can take two more questions. So, yes, please.
You spoke about Carnatic music and cricket, but you didn't mention anything about PG Woodhouse. I've read in your interviews, PG Woodhouse is your favorite writer and all.
Okay, I'll ask you a question. Who's bigger, Mr. Bigger or Master Bigger? Master Bigger because he was a little bigger, according to PG Woodhouse.
My question is, amidst of all these busy schedules, do you find time to read literature? And how this literature reading helps you to enhance your music?
Yeah, I read a lot of books. I read a lot of literature and things not called literature also. And there is a lot of things that are happening when you read a book because you are engaging with a creative mind in your personal capacity. You know, it's almost a one-to-one with the writer when you're actually reading the book, and it gives you a fascinating insight to the way the writer's mind works. You know, in using tools like the language and the lyrical beauty as opposed to context. For instance, when we sing, sometimes you look at ornamentation, sometimes you look at content. So there is always that balance that you work with. Similarly with a writer, you know, you look at those things when you write, when you read somebody, you look at the, for instance, I'm a big fan of Vladimir Nabokov. And I like the way he writes, he uses the language, a Russian guy who thinks in a foreign language and it brings it. It's like me singing Telugu songs. You know, it's a very similar case. You know, I am a native Tamil speaker, but I have to sing Telugu songs or Sanskrit songs. So how do I articulate? See, things like that, you try and understand when you actually read.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that very illuminating and episodic. I like the cricket analogy too. My question to you, in the last 10 years, what is the key factor that influenced your creativity?
My creativity?
Yes, sir.
In the last 10 years, I would say one is the amount of time I spent at home actually singing, because my children insisted that I should sing every day. And that helped me more than anything else, because you know, I had to sing, and my daughter would never stop until I had finished singing her quota of 12 or 13 songs that I have to sing every day. I mean, that is one way of practicing more than anything else. The second is, of course, my exposure to other art forms and interaction with several artists from various disciplines, which gives me a very fascinating insight into the way their mind works. I don't think I would have understood this 20 years back, but definitely today I feel I can understand it better and try and incorporate some of those things into what I do in my art form.
And if I can just add, ask a question also. Who were your particular idols as you were growing up? I mean,
the 80s, it was GNB. GNB was my biggest idol. And then Madhuramani Iyer and the Alathur brothers, then Ramnath Krishnan. Then, you know, every year a new idol came in as I kept discovering them.
I have a question here on the top. Good afternoon, sir. I have a question about is Carnatic music open to modification, or is it restricted to a purist view?
It's open to a lot of modification. No, plenty of people are modifying things continuously.
Because there is a sect which is more purist, which doesn't allow... I mean, I've heard that they are disapproving of involving abhangs and all.
If you want to change, you do go ahead and do it. Don't worry about the purists. They are not going to pay your salary.
Okay.
So don't worry about them. It's okay. They can say what they want to say. The music is free space for you to do whatever you want to do. You want to sing abhangs, you sing abhangs. You want to sing Bengali, you sing. You want to sing French, you sing. Try and hold your audience. That's all is important.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Sanjay, for making the time, for allowing us, to giving us the space after the great honors that have been bestowed on you. Really grateful for having set a lovely tone for our festival. Thank you so much.